वेलकम बैक। सो फार वी हैव अंडरस्टूड द प्रॉब्लम रिलेटेड टू रिप्रेजेंटेशन एंड आफ्टर दैट वी हैव ऑल्सो लर्न दैट हाउ टू टॉक अबाउट द सॉल्यूशन एंड आफ्टर दैट स्टेबिलिटी एंड ऑफ कोर्स वी हैव ऑल्सो डिस्कस द रियलाइजेशन प्रॉब्लम रिलेटेड टू लीनियर टाइम इनवेरिएंट एंड टाइम वेरिंग सिस्टम। सो इन दिस पार्ट ऑफ द कोर्स I am going to talk about the problem related to design, and somehow we are talking about the design of some subsystem such that if I have some certain kind of physical system with given a specification, then I can give guarantee that if I design some subsystem along with our original system, then whole system will show the desired behavior. So before going to the controller design problem, we have to understand some kind of difficulty that is related to the design problem. And in this lecture, I am going to address those two difficulty. And somehow we are going to characterize that difficulty in terms of controllability and observability. And of course, in this course, I am just going to talk about the linear system. So linear time varying system and linear time invariant system. Same kind of problem for nonlinear system is not so much straightforward. That is complicated. And geometrical control theory is required to understand same concept related to controllability and observability of the nonlinear system. So in this course, I am not going to cover that part. So let us start the today's lecture. So suppose I have some linear system. So I am going to take some kind of general linear system like x dot equal to atx and plus bt into u. And after that, suppose I have y into ct into x. For time being, assume that control is not directly connected with the output. And obviously, I am assuming here I have n number of state variables. So x belongs to Rn. And whatever assumption we are assuming that u belongs to Rm and y belongs to Rp. So these kind of things, now we are well aware that whenever we are writing some kind of engineering system, at that time we have to specify this kind of things. We have to specify the initial condition. Now question is that whether or not the state of the state space equation, so here in this above equation x is the state, u is the control input, and y is my output, can be controlled from the input. It means that suppose you have some finite initial condition, and after that, by designing control, is it possible to achieve some other state or not? That is the meaning. And obviously, controllability and another similar kind of notion that is called reachability. But for continuous time system, linear continuous time system, both notion is exactly equal. So due to that reason, first I am going to discuss about controllability. Obviously, in the next lecture, I will talk about reachability also. So meaning of controllability, that if system is controllable, then it is possible to show that I can always design some kind of control. It might possible control is very, very high here. So we are not worrying the magnitude of control. But it is possible to steer a state from one place to another place. And now you are able to understand that somehow if we know that system is controllable, then we are thinking about the design. Suppose if system is not controllable about some particular state variable or something, some particular, then even if you can apply any control, but you are not able to get the desired objective. So how to get desired objective? then only one possibility that you have to need certain modification inside the system. So due to that reason, mean controllability suggests that extra modification is required or not. You can interpret like this also. So due to that reason, before designing the control action, first people are investigating that system is controllable or not. And if in some mechanism or some algebraic way, I will tell you algebraic way in next class, but in today's lecture I am just going to give some kind of physical intuition about controllability and observability. So somehow if we know that system is controllable, then only we are going to explore the different design technique. And due to that reason, before designing the control action, you have to check, you have to make sure that whatever system you have developed, that is controllable. Another important thing that is related to second problem, and second problem is like this: whether or not the initial state can be observed from the output. Why only we are worrying about initial state? If you remember the definition of state, then what we have told, that suppose if you know the input ut and if you know the initial condition of a state, all state variable x0, then it is possible to guess the future trajectory xt, provided we know the dynamical equation. So just two information is required to talk about the future trajectory. And what is that two things? Control, which is designed by user, so obviously that is known to user. And after that, another thing, x0, that is somehow associated with the system. So if I know the initial condition and if I know the dynamical system, then I can talk about the future. Here future is nothing but y equal to cxt. And due to that reason, we are telling that whether or not the initial state can be observed from the output. It means that most of time what happens, that if I have dynamical system, so number of state variable inside the system, that is very much large than the output. So now we are telling that if I have certain kind of measurement, means I have certain kind of sensor, using that I am measuring the output, and based on that measurement, is it possible to know the all state variable? Initial condition of a state variable is enough. If I know the initial condition, then obviously I can talk about the future trajectory. So I am assuming that if initial condition is known, then I can able to understand the behavior of a state in the future also. And due to that reason, second problem is related to the output. So somehow I have some kind of system. So by seeing the output, I am able to understand the internal behavior, because whatever internal behavior, state is only responsible for that. So by seeing the output, I am telling that I know that everything inside the system. And this notion that is related to this, related to the output, and using output, one can measure the initial state, is called observability. We will see the exact definition of controllability and observability in the next class. Another important things in terms of physical element, you try to understand like this: what happens whenever you are designing some control action? At that time, it is possible to show that if I have information of all state variable, then easily one can design the control system, provided I know that system is controllable, particularly for linear system I am talking about. So now suppose I have some nuclear plant, and you might have seen that thousands of states variable are associated with this, and it is very, very difficult to measure all state variable. But suppose, what is now my problem? I have finite number of sensors. Using that, I can measure the output. And based on that measurement, I am telling that I want to design the control action. And when that is possible, if we are able to give guarantee that using finite number of measurement, somehow I am able to estimate all internal state or initial condition of all internal state. So somehow notion of observability also suggests us that what is minimum number of sensors are required to control some plant. So suppose that if you do not know notion of observability, you try to add more sensors to the system, and sensors are very, very costly, and maintenance of sensor is also difficult. Several sensor has its own dynamics that might affect your control system, overall control system. And due to that reason, whenever we are designing control system, we try to minimize the number of sensors. So if you know the notion of observability, then you are able to understand that if my system is nth order or linear system is nth order, then using one or two information, you are able to control whole plant, because minimum number of output is able to characterize the all initial condition. And due to that reason, people are telling that if you know the observability and some criteria related to observability, then somehow you are also able to guess the number of sensors. So we will see this kind of things again in the next lecture. But today we are trying to understand these two concepts. So now I am going to summarize these two concepts again. I have certain kind of linear system, that is time varying or time invariant. Now, notion of controllability tells us that by designing some input, is it possible to steer a state from one position to another position? What observability is suggest that by seeing the output, is it possible to understand about the internal variable? Because if I know the internal variable, if I know the input ut, then I am able to guess the future. Now try to understand the controllability and observability using some kind of physical circuit. So since most of you are related from the electrical engineering, and due to that reason, I am going to take very, very simple system. And you can see that in this particular system, physical system, I have one current source, I have resistor, so I have three resistors, and after that I have capacitor. And I am assuming that here internal variable is the voltage, either voltage across resistor, you can tell, or voltage across this capacitor C1 and C2. Because I have already told you that whenever we are talking about a state, then somehow they are able to capture some kind of memory, and memory is obviously associated with capacitor. And due to that reason, in order to characterize this whole system, two states or two internal information of two internal variable is required. Because resistor is, whenever you are seeing the mathematical equation or physical equation of the resistor, so whatever input you can apply, then output is going to reflect. Same means reflection of output is instantaneous. But if you see the capacitor, then output is also function of the past state. And due to that reason, we are telling that here state associated with this system, I have just two state associated with this system, and output, I have defined output here. And for time being, I am assuming that this circuit is open. Now you can see here that you can design any current source. It is not possible to fix the value of X2. So what is my control problem now? My varying this current source, I am going to change the voltage across this capacitor and voltage across this capacitor. I can obviously change the voltage across this capacitor, but I cannot change voltage across this capacitor. Why? Because this particular part is open. So whatever current I am going to apply, that is flow through this. And due to that reason, I am telling that I cannot control both state variable. I can just able to control one state variable X1, and due to that reason, system is uncontrollable. Means I have no control, or you can apply any current in this particular system, you are not able to control the behavior of X2, and X2 is nothing but voltage across the capacitor. I have also told you that why physically I have selected only two state variable and why is the output voltage. Now try to understand another thing. Suppose you have information of Y output, and suppose you have information of input. Now using these two information, I try to know the initial condition of this capacitor and this capacitor. So try to see here that output is somehow decoupled from X1. So what happens? Whatever current you can apply, that is not going to reflect on the output. And what happens due to that reason? I am able to understand the initial condition of this capacitor by this measurement, but there is no way to know the initial condition of this capacitor. And due to that reason, I am telling that this whatever circuit I have drawn here, that is unobservable. Unobservable means from the information of output and this input and whole circuit, I am not able to predict the initial condition. Because why initial condition only? Because if you know the initial condition, then by knowledge of differential equation, I can predict the future. And due to that reason, information of initial condition is just enough. So by this simple example, one can understand the problem of controllability and observability. Let us try to see this problem again, controllability and observability, by some kind of hypothetical example. Basically, the notion of controllability and observability is introduced by one of the great scientists, that is called R.E. Kalman. And he has given in-depth criteria or some kind of algebraic criteria both for linear system, and later people have extended for nonlinear system also, that how to check controllability and observability of the system. So first try to understand the problem and why this problem is very, very important. So he has taken one hypothetical example of fourth order system. So same example I'm going to repeat in this lecture. And here I have four state variable, X1, X2, X3, and X4. And after that, he told that suppose that I have Y equal to this. So basically, you can see here, U is the control input. So somehow this system I can represent like AX plus BU. So control is here, control is here. So everywhere I have control. So by seeing that, it is possible to think in a glance that by designing control action U, I am able to steer X1, X2, and X3, X4 anywhere, because control is explicitly appear. So one can think, okay, since everywhere control is present, so I can design control action, and after that, I am able to steer X1 and X2, X3 and X4 anywhere. So by definition, without doing further analysis, it might possible people land up to the conclusion that system is controllable, and after that they try to design control action. But it is possible to show that this system is not controllable. So let us see how to show. And after that, they have assumed this kind of observation equation, means this kind of output. Now But he is telling that, okay, first you can express your system in a state space form. And I have already told you that whenever you are representing system in a state space form, then we are representing like this, where A is the system matrix, B is the input matrix, and C is the output matrix. So from this equation, it is very easy to write the system matrix A. After that, B is the input matrix and C is the output matrix. And for time being, you can assume that initially system is in rest. And if system is in rest, then I can talk about the transfer function. And what is transfer function? Laplace transform of output by Laplace transform of input. And in this way, I can define the transfer function. And we have already seen that transfer function HS is also given like CSI minus A inverse and B. So if you perform the calculation, it is possible to show that sum of pole and zero. So we have already seen that what is how to define a pole and zero of some transfer function. So pole is the root of denominator polynomial, zero is the root of numerator polynomial. And you can see that finally what happens, HS is 1 by S plus 1. So what happens, due to some kind of pole zero cancellation, I have just first order system. So if you try to get the transfer function of this particular system, then you are able to conclude that this is first order system, but originally this is fourth order system. And why this kind of things comes into picture? Due to pole zero cancellation. Let us try to see the behavior of this hypothetical system, because in frequency domain, what happens? Due to cancellation, I can not able to characterize the whole behavior of the system, because I know this is my fourth order system. But in frequency domain, after calculating the transfer function, due to pole zero cancellation, I have just first order system. Now, in order to see the behavior, I am going to transfer this system, this hypothetical system, in some other coordinate frame. Why? You try to see here that I have just one input. Here, everywhere, I have just one input, U. It means that I have U belongs to R only. So somehow I am going to transform this system and try to visualize this system in other coordinate frame, such that I am able to draw some kind of conclusion, and obviously conclusion about the controllability and observability. And I have already told you that whenever I have some system, it is possible to introduce some kind of transformation such that I can express that system in some simple form. And one of the simplest transformation that is related to this, that is somehow diagonalization of the matrix. And if you do this kind of diagonalization, so this is the eigenvalue of matrix A, that is minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, and minus 4. So after the transformation, you can now try to look into that, because pi t into b, because you all are well aware that I have x dot equal to ax plus bu, and after that I have introduced this kind of transformation, that is y equal to cx, but I am going to define this kind of transformation z equal to t into x. So basically z dot equal to tx dot, and finally I have t ax plus bu, and after that I can write ta, and now I have x. So again, I am assuming that whatever transformation I have introduced, that is invertible, and after that I have this kind of thing. And due to that reason, this matrix and this matrix multiplication, and we have already know that TAT inverse can be selected, means T is selected in such a way, because A I know, lambda is nothing but the all eigenvalue I have placed along the diagonal axis, then I can in that way I can select the transformation, and in transform coordinate you can see the system. Now here what happens, now output contain two transform variable z1 and z2. Initially try to see that at output it seems that information of all states are reflected in original coordinate frame, because I have fourth order system, x1, x2, x3 and x4. All state information is reflected, but that is not the reality, because we have already seen that if I change the coordinate frame, then whatever behavior in the transform coordinate frame, that is exactly same as the original frame, provided whatever transformation I have introduced, that should be invertible. So I can move from first domain to second, first coordinate to second coordinate, and vice versa. So in original coordinate frame, system looks like very, very complicated, but in transform coordinate frame, system has very simple structure. Now try to see that in this fourth order system, control is explicitly appear about two state. Control is appear here, and after that control is appear here. After that you try to see the output. Only two states, z1 and z2, are reflected about the output. Apart from these two state, you can see that z2 equal to -2 z2, and I have already told you by means geometrical analysis of differential equation, I can conclude that I can start with any initial condition. After very, very large time, I will converge to the equilibrium point. And in other way, this particular subsystem is globally asymptotically stable. Similarly, this system is also globally asymptotically stable. So what happens, that whatever value z2, z4 you can select, finally that will converge to the zero. So I have no control about these two states, z2 and z4, because whatever value I can select, control will not do anything, finally that equal to zero. Here you try to see that at least I can control z1 and z3. Because I have control in our hand, so I can place z1 at any desired location. So suppose you have to place z1 at location zr, then I can define z1 minus zr, and suppose zr is constant for time being, then I can manipulate error e dot equal to z1 dot, and z1 dot is nothing but minus z1 and plus u, and after that you can design u, that is z1, and after that minus k into e, where k greater than 0. Then what happens, that your closed loop system after designing this kind of control is nothing but e dot equal to minus k into e. And you know the behavior of this differential equation, here e belongs to r only, so e is 0, so it is possible to place z1 at any desired location. Similarly, I can place z3 at any desired location, but I have no control for z2 and z4. And due to that reason, means this system, since transform system is not controllable, so original system is also not controllable. So if we are unable to control one state, then system, whole system is called uncontrollable. Now try to understand another thing. You can see that across the output, only two states are reflected, Z1 and Z2 are reflected. But by knowing Y and U, I have no way to know about the other two states. And due to that reason, this system is also unobservable. So if one state is unobservable, then we are telling that whole system is unobservable. In this way, we are characterizing the controllable and observable system. So here, by coordinate transformation, we are able to understand the behavior of the system. But obviously, in next class, I will give you some kind of algebraic condition, and using that algebraic condition, you are able to understand the controllability and observability of linear time invariant system and linear time varying system. So in this way, at least we are able to understand that how uncontrollability and unobservability comes into picture whenever original system, even if original system, it looks like that control is appeared everywhere with respect to all state variable. In output, all states are reflected, but originally the system is uncontrollable and unobservable. Now, let us try to see from this observation, Kalman has concluded following thing. So, what he told that, suppose you have any system. So, first he talked about linear time invariant system, x dot equal to ax plus bu, y equal to cx. Again, here I am assuming that x belongs to Rn, u belongs to Rp, and y belongs to belongs to Rm and y belongs to Rp. So either you can write m here, p here, that doesn't matter. That is just notation. So he told that first, in order to understand the decomposition of the system, whole system, first try to draw the block diagram of this particular transform system in coordinate z1, z2, z3, z4, and after that y. So if you draw the block diagram, then it is possible to show. So please check it, because this is very, very simple. This represents the integrator. And here, what is my first system? My system, first system is z1 dot equal to minus z1 plus u. So u is coming from here. After that, this is z1. So minus z1 is coming from here. And after that, integrating this, I am getting z1. And y is nothing but z1 plus z2. So plus plus here I have. And in that way, I will get z1 and z2. If you see the second differential equation, then that is z2 equal to minus 2z2. So here you can see that second part is not connected to input. Obviously, this y z2 is going to appear on the output, but there is no connection of this block, this particular block, with this input. So I cannot control it. Similarly, here you can see that third block, and its equation is like this, z3 equal to minus 3z3 and plus u. So I have coupling with respect to control, but this is not reflected on the output. So this system is controllable but not observable. And this system, last system, is not connected with any input and any output. And due to that reason, this is uncontrollable and unobservable. So I have four different kind of category. So first system, subsystem, you can see that this whole thing makes some complicated system, fourth order complicated system. But if you see the first subsystem, then that is controllable as well as observable. Second system is observable but not controllable. Third system is controllable but not observable. And fourth system is not controllable, not observable. And due to that reason, Kalman has suggested that any system can be transformed into at least four subsystems. Sometimes it might be possible that that will fall in first class only, means system is controllable and observable. In some case, I have, it means that either I have this four possibility or one of them or two of them or three of them. So in this way, I can understood the decomposition of system in four different category, that is both controllable and observable, uncontrollable but observable, controllable but unobservable, neither controllable nor observable. I have already told you that if we are able to see at least one state, we are not able to steer from one point to desired point, then we are telling that that particular system is uncontrollable. Similarly, for observability, observable. Now let us try to see one more behavior. What we have found here, that if you see the transfer function, because I have calculated the transfer function, and during calculation of transfer function, what happens, that fourth order system and whatever transfer function I have obtained, their order is only one. It is possible to show that order of transfer function is nothing but that is determined only by controllable and observable subsystem. So in this particular decomposition, because this is related to the fourth order hypothetical example, you can see that only one subsystem is controllable and observable, and due to that reason, whatever transfer function we will get, that is related to this controllable and observable system. But in transfer function, these three system is somehow disappear due to pole zero cancellation. It means that if something is not controllable and not observable, then frequency domain will not help us. And why this kind of things happens? Because you know that using transfer function, somehow we are relating between input and output, and due to that reason, this kind of things comes into picture. And next remark is that if transfer function of a single input, single output system is of lower degree than the dimension of the state space, then system must contain an uncontrollable subsystem or unobservable system, or possibly both. And we have seen from this example, because here in this particular example, U belongs to R, and Y also belongs to R, because Y is combination of X1, X2, and X3. So somehow Y belongs to R, and due to that reason, this is about single input, single output system. So first try to understand for single input, single output system, and after that, people has generalized this result for multi-input, multi-output system also. So we will, for understanding the idea, first you try to understand the single input, single output system, and after that, once you understood the idea, then we will extend same kind of notion for multi-input, multi-output system. Now, one more thing, what we have observed, that suppose we have uncontrollable and unobservable system. So sometime what happens, that even if my system is uncontrollable, but whatever state which we cannot control, but they have such kind of a structure, such that means in absence of the control input also, they are not going to grow. Because if you see that in this particular example, I have two states, that is Z1 and Z2. And if you see the dynamics of that, so that is globally asymptotically stable, because now you are knowing the notion of stability. So you are able to talk about this. And if you have confusion, then just you can apply the geometrical analysis by plotting or drawing one line. So you can give any initial condition of Z2 and Z4. What happens? These two subsystem is uncontrollable, but finally their value is going to become zero. So that will not affect the stability of our system, because we know that finally somehow I have to stabilize everything at equilibrium point or some point. So this will never destabilize our system. But suppose if plus sign is here, then what happens? You can design any control action, but this system, somehow state of this system is going to increase, and somehow this uncontrollable state will destabilize our whole system. So even if you design very, very sophisticated control system, but you are not able to stabilize your system, because whatever uncontrollable state, and if dynamics in such a way, such that is going to increase with respect to time, then finally your whole system is going to collapse. So I have now two different category. inside the uncontrollable and unobservable system. Sometimes uncontrollable and unobservable state is also stable. And if that is stable, then we are telling system as stabilizable. And what is detectable? That if unobservable state is again stable. So actually, if that is inherently stable, then that will not basically affect our stabilization problem or controller design problem. And similarly, even if I am not able to detect that state, I can predict the future. Because finally, after long run, what happens? That system is stable. So they are going to settle somewhere. So there is no need to worry. So what happens? That this mathematical problem is first coined by Kalman, and at that time frequency domain is too much dominated. Then what happens? Frequency domain people start telling that this is just some kind of mathematical problem that is not related to any physical system. So obviously now we have to give certain example of physical system when similar kind of problem occur. And obviously first I have started with physical example, but at that time Kalman is somehow means very much inclined toward mathematics, and due to that reason he has created mathematical system. But try to understand that uncontrollability and unobservability is very, very common. Most of time, if you are not careful, even if you can design some system, somehow your system become unstable. Or unstable means you are not able to get whatever you are thinking after building the system. So let us try to see that one of the common cause of uncontrollable system is first cause, that is called redundant state variable. It means that somehow if I define unnecessary state variable, and this kind of things happens particularly in system. Why? Because most of time if my system is very, very much complicated, then law of physics are not clear. Because law of physics, whatever we have developed, suppose Newton's law is developed for mass, suppose if you are applying for some kind of force related to a spring, that is actually developed for a spring. But now if I have combination of a spring, mass, or capacitor, inductor, some kind of electronic circuit, so lot of combination, whatever system we are developing, that is very, very sophisticated. So even if we are applying the physics, but most of time we are not able to understand that how many state variable or minimum number of state variable is able to capture my system such that I can control that system. So one of the way engineers are doing, first they try to involve all kind of state variable, and they are going to create differential equation with respect to all state variable. Suppose some kind of state variable suddenly comes, and this kind of state variable is appear due to coupling, that I have some system x dot equal to ax plus bu, and x here belongs to rk. And suppose I have some kind of coupling variable z, and which relate x and z by this kind of equation. And here I am assuming that this matrix f that belongs to n and k. So basically z belongs to Rn. So here z belongs to Rn. Now here you can see that if you calculate z dot, then again some dynamical system comes into picture. And now I have a state variable here. This belongs to Rk, this belongs to Rn. So basically x belongs to R k plus n. So I have k plus n number of state variable. And if you write it into a state space representation, then I have this kind of form. And that is very, very obvious. And after that, now you can see that if you see this system, then I have this kind of block diagram. So suppose I have connected my system, and here you can see that whole system means control input is available to that redundant system also. So what we are thinking that my original system as well as coupled system, that both are controllable. But what happens, this kind of state, which is called unnecessary state or redundant state Z, and somehow what they are going to do, they are going to make our system uncontrollable. So let us try to see again. Most of time in this lecture, I am just going to use transformation because I do not know till now that how to define controllability and observability in algebraic way. But I know that one system can be analyzed in different coordinate frame. And suppose I have defined this kind of transformation where IK is identity matrix and order of identity matrix is K, K cross K matrix, where all diagonal entry is 1, and similarly here IN. So if you see the transform system, then this kind of structure basically comes into picture. That is pretty easy to see, and we know that how basically this transformation comes into picture. Now let us try to see here what happens. This is the extra state, and in transform coordinate, control is only appear about this X bar. Means somehow I cannot control the state of this system. Here this is input, so that become constant. And by seeing the differential equation also, you are able to understand that I can control X bar, but I cannot control Z bar because Z bar is constant. So somehow this Z bar is not going to destabilize my system, but I cannot control this. And due to that reason, this system become uncontrollable. So most of time, if you are using higher order of differential equation to represent your system, then it might possible that whatever system during analysis, it's look like that your system is uncontrollable. And due to that reason, people are telling that again, one separate research is required to select that how many minimum number of state information is required to control the plant. So, and somehow controllability is also addressed that. So due to that reason, you have to understand the controllability, and I will tell you more story about the observability. In this lecture, I have just collected several examples which cause the loss of controllability and observability. So why this kind of situation comes into picture, I have already told you that most of time my process is very, very complicated. We are unfamiliar with the physics, and control engineer try to write differential equation, whatever things that come in their eye. And due to that reason, I have several unnecessary differential equation, and that will cause somehow the uncontrollable state. Now let us try to understand some kind of physical system where uncontrollability comes into picture. And most of time, it is possible to show that if some force we are applying the internally, then this kind of situation comes into picture. So suppose here I have some kind of system. Here I have, you can see that mass coupled with some kind of spring. And this kind of system is very much common. Here I have removed the damper in order to understand this problem of uncontrollability. So I have two system that is simply connected with some kind of spring, where spring force is K. And suppose here center of mass of this system is here, center of mass of this system is here, and distance from this axis is x1, means position of first block and position of second block. Now in addition of a spring force, I have certain kind of active control force that is going to act, and we are going to apply this control force in such a way such that whatever value of control force that is going to act on first mass, so similar kind of control force is going to act on second mass. And most of time we are doing in order to make certain distance between these two blocks, because it might possible if I do not apply some kind of active mechanism, then these two blocks may collide. And due to that reason, people are applying some kind of force F by certain kind of mechanism. Let us try to write differential equation now. So we know that dx1 by dt equal to x1 dot. X1 dot is nothing but velocity. And after that, I have to write the force by Newton's law. So dx1 dot by dt, and that is, this is pretty simple, because now you are knowing that you are several times you solve this kind of problem, that this force is acting in this direction, and after that means since this block is moving, then we are writing force across this. So here I have kx1 is in this side, kx2, and after that resultant force we are writing, and after that we are just equating. So in this way I can get this kind of equation, and I have told you that this force, if that will act on this direction for first, then in second block that is going to act in opposite direction, and due to that reason this kind of differential equation comes into picture. Now let us try to see the center of mass of this particular system, because we know that if no external force here, if you see the external force, because whatever internal force I have applied, that is balanced, so somehow I can tell that whole force, total force on this system is all due to internal mechanism. There is no external force, and you already know the conservation of center of mass. And if this mathematical equation also supports that physical phenomena, so here you try to see that m1 dx1 by dt, m2 dx2 by dt, and it is possible to show that d by dt by this equation, you can just substitute everything, then that equal to 0. And what is m1 x1 plus m2 x2? I can write as a mxc, and in this way I can able to calculate the center of mass. So thus center of mass of the system cannot be moved by the internal force. So we have seen. Now try to do some kind of matrix analysis to support this statement, and after that try to understand that why I am telling that something is uncontrollable. And here, before going to do matrix analysis, I am going to tell you that I am going to show that independently I cannot place x1 and x2 at any arbitrary position. I can manipulate the relative distance between x1 and x2, but I cannot independently manipulate the x1 and x2. So that kind of things I am going to show, and due to that reason I am going to tell that x1 and x2 is not independently controllable. So for that, what I am going to do, I am going to first write the differential equation into a state space or matrix representation, because, and after that I will, to applying transformation is a little bit easy in that way. So I know the center of mass xc, and after that relative distance between two system, that is x1 minus x2, that I have defined delta, and x1c dot you can easily define, that is not a big issue, because x1 is changing with respect to time, x2 is changing with respect to time, so I can hope that xc dot is also changing with respect to time, and after that delta x1 and x2 is changing, so delta is changing. Now if you write everything in coordinate of xc, delta xc dot and delta dot, then it is possible to show that I have again T matrix, and if I define T matrix like this, after that this whole system can be transformed system. Let us directly come to the transformed system, that is looks like this: dxc dt equal to xc dot, d delta dt by delta dot, and dxc dot by dt equal to 0, and after that you try to see here that I have d delta dot equal to dt by this. So where control is going to appear now? Control is just going to appear across the delta. And what is my delta? That is relative distance, x1 and x2. So I can change delta, but I cannot change x1 and x2. And here also you can see that center of mass remains constant, and this differential equation is suggesting that. So it means that internal force F can change the distance delta between x1 and x2, but not coordinate x1 and x2 independently. And due to that reason, system is uncontrollable. So external force is always required to change the relative position and x1 and x2. So due to, if we are just applying the internal force and somehow internal force is balanced, then uncontrollability kind of situation comes into picture. That is the message. Another important thing, that if system has too much symmetry, and this kind of things comes into picture, particularly for mechanical system or electrical system. And I hope that you are all are knowing about balance bridge. Here I haven't I am not going to discuss how basically this differential equation comes into picture. So just you can apply KVL and KCL, and after that try to check that whatever differential equation I have written, that is correct or not. So I have, what happens in this particular circuit, here I have R1 C1 and R2 C2. So if R1 C1 equal to R2 C2, then we are telling that whatever bridge, that bridge is balanced. Now try to see the voltage difference between V1 and V2. Now if bridge is balanced, then now I am going to trying to control the voltage V1 and V2. So let us see that, is it possible or not. So first, again, I will write the differential equation. And again, what I am going to do, I am going to write differential equation in terms of the voltage difference between V1 and V2. So if you write differential equation, then I will get this kind of things. And from here, you can see that if R1 C1 and R2 C2 equal to 0, then what happens? If that is 0, then it is possible to show that V1 bar is exponentially stable or asymptotically, globally asymptotically stable. Means V1 bar is 0 as t tending towards 0. It means that in this situation, due to this differential equation, V1 is always equal to V2. Or in this way, what I am telling, that I cannot put arbitrary value across V1 and V2. Whatever value I am going to change, so V1 and V2, V1 and minus V2, that is always equal to 0, it means that V1 is always equal to V2. Now, due to that reason, I am telling that I cannot independently control V1 and V2 from this analysis, and due to that reason, this system is uncontrollable due to highly symmetry. Now try to see the observability problem related to this. I am assuming that I have some kind of mechanism to measure the difference between this voltage V1 and V2. And after that, now I am going to formulate the observability problem and try to see that what I am going to do. I am assuming that I am going to assume that if I have information of V1 minus V2, then is it possible to calculate V2 or not? And due to that reason, I have defined another state V2 bar, that is nothing but V2. And after that, I am going to write the differential equation in terms of V1 and V2. That is pretty easy, because you know that what is V1 and V2 dot from differential equation, you can just substitute it. And after that, transform everything in terms of V1 and V2, then you will get this kind of equation. Try to see the block diagram of this particular system. Now I have two observation, means I have one sensor which is going to measure this V1 that is going to measure this difference V1 and V2 that I have defined as a V1 bar. So if you see the block diagram of this system and try to see that if R1, the bridge is balanced, R1 C1 equal to R2 C2, then what happens? This particular block, whatever particular block here I have, this equal to 0 and this equal to, again, this star block equal to 0. Then what happens? Somehow my circuit is disconnected. And actually what happens in output Y, you can see that there is no path from V2 to Y. So I have, from Y, I can only able to observe the V1, and I am assuming that their information is available to me. but there is no way to measure V2, and due to that reason we are telling that this system is unobservable also. So this is neither controllable nor observable. Now let us try to see the another means by which unobservability comes into picture. So suppose I have certain kind of system and a structure of system is like this. So some system, you can see that some system somehow I have to decouple system, that is couple using some kind of variable, and output I'm measuring like this. So output somehow second subsystem output is not encountered here, and due to that reason using one sensor I cannot control x1 and x2 independently, or I cannot measure x1 and x2 independently. So let us try to see one simple problem. Suppose you have one mass of m, and after that by applying u I want to control x, position of this mass, and I have one sensor which is just going to measure the x dot. Then try to understand the problem. Now what happens, I am going to design some kind of control system, and that will provide u to me, and after that as a feedback I am going to apply x dot. So I have just put one sensor which is going to measure the velocity. I am not going to use the position sensor, so I am going to take feedback of this. It is possible to show whatever sophisticated control you can design, you are not able to control x precisely, because you can see here that x is coming from the integration of x dot. So whenever you are integrating something, then what happens, always some integration constant comes into picture. So precisely you never able to control the position if there is no explicit information of position in order to design the control system. And due to that reason I have told you that observability also tells that how minimum number of sensor is required to design the control action. So in this way, perhaps now you are able to understand the message of controllability and observability. So what happens that sometime if we are just writing differential equation in original coordinate frame or some coordinate frame, system looks like controllable, but that is not that is not the same. It might possible that system is not controllable. In original coordinate frame, sometimes system is looking unobservable. So, but that is not the case. So somehow I have to give some kind of algebraic mechanism or some kind of geometrical mechanism to make sure that whenever I have some system that is controllable and observable. If my system is controllable and observable, what is beauty? Using frequency domain I can analyze, because whatever transfer function that is coming, that is only due to controllable and observable, particularly for single input single output system. Another way, if I know something is controllable, then I can go for designing the control. If system is not controllable, then why I will explore the controller design problem? I have to again modify my system. And due to that reason, whenever you are building some system, first you have to check that whatever system I have built, that is controllable or not. Similarly, you have to build that some kind of mechanism to make sure that your system is observable or not. If that is not observable, then what happens? You are not able to control some positions in a specific way, or you are not able to understand the internal behavior of whole system. And due to that reason, these two problems are very, very important. And in next class, I am going to talk about the algebraic criteria, because here I am using transformation, and based on transformation, by looking the differential equation, by looking the block corresponding to that differential equation, we are concluding something. But most of time, order of system is very, very high. And using this way, it is very difficult to make any kind of conclusion. And due to that reason, some algebraic criteria is required. It is possible to show that if you are able to understand the means system is controllable, and you are able to formulate some kind of controllability criteria, based on that criteria, you are also able to design the control system. So that is the very important topic. And in next class, I am going to discuss that. So with this discussion, I am going to close the today's lecture. Thank you very much.